Yeah, that seems to be the repeated message everywhere I go.
Does it?
Training, training, more training.
Yeah.
And it's not that it has to be, it's just that that's what's going to make them feel better about you and you be more comfortable in the field.
And when you actually get in the field, it's with, right? You're always learning.
Right.
But at least if you know the process, you get in the field, it makes it so much easier.
Yeah. Having a framework, having a system, even if later on you change the system to suit you, about, you think you, it's more comfortable for you to run claims. If you got something to start with, got a little boat so you can sit in with a, or, you know,
even
later on,
a little bit, you got one toe in the
bottom. Then later on, you can like upgrade to a speed boat or change the color of your oar or whatever you want to do.
Exactly correct. You know, I tell all my students that no matter what training you get in, me or whatever, you got to do 100 claims because then you will have seen all of the scenarios.
Yeah.
Maybe not all of them, but most of them, you'll see the different parts and pieces. And that's really where the education comes in, is once you get in the field.
This is Adjuster TV, adjusters first. Adjuster TV is brought to you by Kaplik. Learn all about E&O and other insurance for adjusters at cplic.net/adjuster TV. And by Adjuster TV Plus. Get unlimited access to a growing library of the best adjuster training videos created by the most trusted name in claims, Adjuster TV, at adjusterTVplus.com.
What's up, everybody? Matt here with Adjuster TV. And for the best tips and tools for getting on the first call list, subscribe on YouTube. Well, actually, this is... if you're watching this on YouTube, then it's pre-recorded, but we're actually doing this live at NACA. And I've got here one of my fast track to deployment students, Shane Kruger, who has passed. And so what we're going to do is we're taking questions from our community, the fast track to deployment community. Mr. Guy Grand from Veteran Adjusting School has promised to come by, but we're just going to kind of hang out for a little bit, chit chat, and see if we can get some questions answered. So, Shane, how's it going, man?
Going good, good, good. How about you?
Doing well. This is always a really fun event. So, talk to me a little bit about your experience so far on the NACA convention.
So far, it has been, kept me really busy. Got to meet a lot of people. That is probably the most important thing about being here, is making connections, meeting people that have a lot more experience. That could, obviously I have none just starting out, and they give me opportunity to talk to them, get some advice, some information. Obviously you have to take some of it with a grain of salt, but there's a lot of experience here, and then a chance to meet all kinds of different vendors. You know, not only the IA firms, but there's also some, you know, ladder assist firms.
Right.
It's the some of the, like, I don't think Hover's here. I haven't seen Hover, but there's another one called Advanced Something Technologies. They're here.
Yeah.
So it's just an opportunity to meet a lot of people that are in the industry and get some knowledge from their experience. It's been really good for me for a couple of days. Wears me out. Definitely tiring.
You're on your feet all day.
A lot. Yes, definitely.
So have you taken any of the CE or training classes?
Nope. I've spent most of my time doing interviews, trying to fill out applications, getting on the rosters, basically the way I've spent my time since it's my first time here. At some point, I'm sure there'll be some continued education, but not this trip.
Hey there, I hope you're enjoying this live stream Q&A replay from the 2023 NACA convention in Las Vegas. If you missed this signature conference, all hope is not lost. There are a number of outstanding events coming up in the next several weeks, and one of the biggest ones, and I mean another can't miss conference, is the Crawford CatCon conference that will be held in Allen, Texas, February 19th through the 23rd. This is a big deal event that includes trainings and CEs, as well as, in my opinion, the most important thing, networking. Adjuster TV attended this conference last year, and we're slated to be there again this year, so we hope to see you there. Visit crawco.com/cat right now to register for this very important IA firm conference. All right, back to the Q&A.
How many interviews have you done so far?
I'm guessing probably around 19. They don't take very long. They generally, you know, if there's somebody to do an interview with you,
yeah,
they'll grab you, take you. If not, then they give you their information to fill out to get on their roster, and then they'll email you. Most of them are going to send you something back. So, yeah, it's been keeping me busy for sure. doing everything I can to get on as many as I can, and hopefully something good will come of that.
Right on. So now have you, so you graduated in like August, was it?
I graduated December.
December, okay.
Yep. It was your September class.
Okay. And we did the July one too.
Yeah, and I missed, it was your September class. I missed the whole week of the actual class. I did everything recorded because I had a vacation. And then when I got back, I did everything from there and then actually finished it up in December.
Okay. Maybe kind of give us, for folks listening at home who are not FTD students, maybe kind of give a little bit of a description of like what the program's about, like in your own words.
So basically the program, he has it broke up in 5 modules and takes you from beginning to end, how to schedule your time, how to use your time wisely, the ins and outs of not only what to do, but what not to do, which is just as important, seems to me, as what to do. And then basically got to some good education in Xactimate, got to learn how to use that. I don't know exactly how many claim scenarios, but I want to say it was somewhere around between 8 and 10 at least. In fact, probably more than that, because I think the module 5 alone had 4 or 5 on it. So it's probably between 10 and 15 of doing some Xactimate scenarios, learned how to scope a claim, write a claim, learned how to do the F9 notes, the activity diary, just learned a lot of different things. And basically there's just a lot of information there that as I've gone around here to the different vendors and different IA firms, found out is going to be very useful information because things, I mean, I'll be honest, I mentioned what my training was and talk to them about it. And a lot of them are actually very surprised with the depth of your training. The ones, I know you have agreements with some of them,
right?
But some of the ones I don't think you do. And I talked to them about where one of them was, what was his name? I wish I could remember. I can't remember. I talked to one guy that I think maybe it was Allied, but he said, wow, really? I've got to go talk to that guy. So when I explain to them what the training is and the depth of the training, they're actually surprised. So it's definitely, obviously, some good training.
Awesome.
So it's been good.
Okay, cool. So in coming to this conference and talking to these people, are there any questions or anything that's come up in your mind that we can talk about?
You know, I think...
Please say yes.
Yeah, I'm thinking. I think basically the big thing for me is how to get started. And, you know, I think you've given a lot of information that not only in the program, but and throughout your videos on Adjuster TV, but it seems to me like the big thing is connections and to stay on top of everything. Once you start filling out resumes or not resumes, but once you start filling out applications, trying to get on rosters, every one of them says to update your, any kind of training you get or anything, get back on there, yeah. Update it every single time you do something. And for me, I guess, you know, a question to you, would be, what do you think the most important thing is, not just to be in front of them, but to kind of keep their attention and yet not be bothering them? It seems like there's a certain level that I'm thinking as I leave here, I get an email, then do it. You know, what steps would you take after that?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think I would not think in terms of, am I going to bother them or not? I would say, like they said, you know, anytime that you have a new certification, a new license, some new training that you've done, call them up, call HR, call whoever and say, hey, I got a new thing. You know, I just want to update my profile. Just checking in, you know, if anything's going on, I think I'm ready to go, you know, that kind of thing. I would also try to always, you know, I always say, this is, if you're going to attend one event, attend this one. But most of the IA firms have their own, like, you have to go to the carrier certifications for sure if you want to handle claims for State Farm or Allstate or whoever. But if they have other little meet and greet things, if they have, hey, we're doing an ABCs of adjusting, you know, kind of training or whatever, attend all that stuff as much as you can. Because the more they see your face and they hear your name, you know, the better it's going to be for you in the long run. Because then, you know, as a new person, you know, it's, you know, no matter what training you take, even if it's with Veteran Adjusting School or whoever, your real first, like, you really start getting people's attention when you get claims and you, you know, close files and they see how you perform when you work. That's kind of like the real, your true interview, right? You could, right. You could be like having a level 3 certification and have been a general contractor for 25 years and all this stuff.
Right.
And, but if you can't close files and do it with friendliness, then you're not going to be successful. And I know I've seen it a lot of times, people that will spend tens of thousands of dollars on all this stuff, and then, but they don't have that one key piece, like their mindset about what this work is about, and they're not prepared for the pressure that's going to come to bear on your first event, which, you know what, it's just like anything else. We go to the gym, if you, anything you like, you learn how to play the piano or the guitar, the first like day is going to be the hardest day, right? And then it'll progressively get easier that the more you do it, right? Mm-hmm. So they know that you're under a lot of pressure on your first event, because they're putting it on you, right? Everybody's piling pressure on you.
Right.
But you come through, you're producing, you're closing claims, you're not scoping, getting over scoped, right? You don't, if it's one a day, if you can reasonably close one claim the same day you scoped it, then that's what you do for, you know, a few days, and then you can ramp up from there. And it gets, what it really takes just like seeing the process a few times before you're like, okay, now I know exactly what needs to be in this file.
Right.
You know, from here, it's just kind of like trimming the fat, sculpting it into something that, you know, is as a clean file, as a thorough file. They know you're a beginner. They want to see that you're, you know, they know you're going to start from zero. They want to see you improve, just like anything else, right? So
yeah. And that makes sense. And that's something, one thing that you touched on that I have heard a lot, especially from the bigger IA firms, is like you said, they have their own conferences or their own training sessions. And it seems to me that one of the best ways to maybe start with them is to go to those and do training directly from them.
Yeah.
It seems to me that that's really important to them that they've done some form of training with you.
Yeah.
So that's one thing I'm noticing, especially, like I said, the bigger firms, I've noticed that with the smaller firms, I don't think they have as much training available,
right?
But the bigger ones definitely do. They have the resources and they definitely want you to access those resources. So if you get on their roster, it seems like it'd be a really good idea to take your time, go down there for a week of training or whatever they're trying to get you to do, because that's going to put you in front of them. But then they also know they've trained you.
Right.
So that's something, some information I've gathered from multiple sources at this point. So it definitely seems like it's a good thing to do.
Yeah, for sure. And I will say that right now is, I've been doing this for a long time, and I've kind of watched there's cycles, right? So like sometimes they'll, you know, when you're running claims, they'll be like, you know, just pay for whatever, just pay for everything. Don't even worry about it. We're not depreciating and blah, blah, blah. And then the next year, the next storm, they're like, hey, listen, you know, we need to really tighten everything up, and we're not paying for drip edge, we're not paying for whatever, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And so it's cyclical that way, but it's also cyclical with the firms where they will pile a lot of resources into their training programs. They'll acquire another firm that has a training school, like these guys right here, and then the training programs for these companies usually are loss leaders, honestly, because they're not charging nearly as much as like the open market or a third party company would, if anything, right? So right now, 2023, I would say take advantage of any kind of low cost or free training that you can get from the firms, mm-hmm. because the chances that it's going to be there in 2024 or 2026 or whatever, it could be gone. They might close it down, because what happens is that a lot of these companies will put all this money into training adjusters. It'll be $99 for a 10-day boot camp, which is, you might as well be free, right? They're not even going to pay the guy that's training the class for that. And then the adjusters that they train go work for somebody else, or it's really, really, you know, there's not a lot of work, and so they go back to being a golf pro or selling shoes or whatever. Right. They're like, well, why are we wasting all this money? Some new CEO will come in and be like, well, we're wasting a bunch of money here, and they'll cut the program, right? And they'll sell the building and whatever. So definitely take the advantage of all that. Any training you can get your hands on, I would absolutely try to take third-party live in-person training. You know, it's I'm not going to sit here and say FTD is like the one thing that you need to do, and you'll be off to, you know, it's designed to help you if that's all you can do. But if you want to be have it be like, you know, if you were going to run a marathon, you know, you could run 1 mile a day, one day a week for, you know, a year and probably do okay. But if you, you know, run 5 days a week and you go 5 miles, you know, per run, I mean, you're going to do better. So the more preparation you do, the more practice you have, the better off you're going to be. Take advantage of the free trainings or low cost trainings that the firms have, their networking events or opportunities, you know, for those to get in the see, you're going to see all these same guys, Crawford guys, at their training center, teaching you their Xactimate level one or their this thing or their whatever thing. Right. So, that's, I can't remember what your question was, honestly, but that's the answer to it.
Yeah. No. And I think, one big thing is that another question that I kind of have for you is, it seems to, this is something I've heard more from the adjusters here that have experience, not so much from the IA firms, is because something I was looking at doing was maintaining my full-time job, getting as many certifications as I can, licenses as I can, and as much training as I can, and then kind of take it on slow, maybe take some daily claims. And then when a big opportunity comes up, you know, I have some experience, I'm more ready for it. But it seems to be a lot of the guys with experience think that, or just tell you, well, you're not going to get any daily claims till you've got a claim somewhere. And the only way you're going to get started is to be out on a cat or
right,
whatever. And that tends to be like a repeated theme from a lot of them. Not all of them, but a lot of them. So I guess maybe, you know, my question of your knowledge, what you know, do you see some new guys get daily claims, or does it tend to always be you've got to hit that storm, or your opportunity is probably not going to come up until that storm, and they need so many people that they need new people?
Right. Yeah. So there's a little bit of complexity to it because it depends on, you know, if there's, where do you live?
I live in Denver, Colorado.
Okay. Yeah. So Denver gets hit with hail every single year, I think. Or at least
somewhere in there does.
Somewhere in the Front Range it does. So the daily stuff is a little bit of an open question. It depends on the firm.
Right.
And I think that I've had some firms tell me, yeah, well, you know, we'll try a person out, you know, give them one or two claims. The kind of thing, if you have construction background or sales, you know, like kind of a background, then, you know, you might get some of that. Or if you like went to veteran adjusting school or MOCAT, you know, where they, you're, it's getting a lot of hands-on training. Even if you talk to like some companies that are working with some of the bigger carriers, they may say, yes, we can do that because they have a need in an area. But it may be that they, which, you know, for your situation where you're like, you're in Denver and you want to stay there, kind of ramp, slide into it. Mm-hmm. If they're like, well, we could send you to New Mexico, that's not really going to help you. But I think if you jump on doing some of the virtual stuff, that's a lot easier depending on what's going on. There may not be a whole lot of volume, which would be fine for you.
Right.
Where you can say, you know, it's in the app, accept or decline. Right. So, so you're like, well, I can't do that one. You know, this one on Saturday, I could take that one, accept. And then you go photoscope it or whatever. That kind of thing. But, you know, it's hard to say.
Yeah.
I don't want to say
depending on the firm and their work.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't want to like say, well, yeah, you absolutely could totally do that, because that's, you know.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm getting is it's going to be, it may depend on the firm, what they have, what their needs are. Yeah. So I think that's definitely something. There's another question for you. Do you know which firms do the virtual, have the, yeah, basically it's like an app that more or less like your Instacart or something where they'll send this out, you can take it or not take it.
Right, right. Crawford has We Go Look. Pilot has Pilot Services On Demand, which is their inspectors on demand program. I don't know that I'm sure Eberl's got something.
Yeah.
Hey, Josh, you got a virtual like photo and scope program? Some kind? Like a virtual adjusting? No, like you know, it's like an app based sort of like come on out and, you know. Except this, you're in the area. This is, there's a loss or a roof claim or whatever, accept or decline kind of a program. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Eberl's got one, and I think Pacesetter's got their Evo program. So
when a claim comes in through Xactimate, I'm talking in the camera. When a claim comes in through Xactimate, okay, I'm coming.
Yeah, jump on in.
What's happening, camera?
So introduce yourself to the folks at home.
I'm Josh with Eberl Claim Service. I'm a recruiter, been working with Eberl's for almost 5 years now. So it's my third time at NACA, having a great time. Yeah, it's been good so far.
Yeah.
But yeah.
The question we were kind of talking about was, you know, so in his situation, he lives in Denver and he's got his day job, right? He's not ready to like if you had a big cat in St. Louis or something, he's not ready to go jump on that.
Sure.
Because even if he was like had all his training, everything all fully lined up, he doesn't want to go just yet. He wants to wait till March, April, May, yeah, something like that. But he's wondering, are there ways for him to get a little bit of hands-on experience in the meantime, like with virtual claims or maybe daily, something like that?
Yeah, and that's a really good question. I think it's kind of a catch-22 of this industry. You hear this all the time. You know, I need an adjuster with experience. I need an adjuster with experience. You know, how do I get this experience if you're only hiring people with experience? And so that's a very common question. You know, I think everybody kind of wants to start out with daily, and it's just a hard thing, I think, for firms especially, is for us to be able to put resources into training people on daily claims. The reason it works and is so successful on a cat and why we like to do it is because you go out, you know, a hailstorm hits Denver, you know, I've got my house right here and there's hail here. Well, the next claim I'm going to do down the block, it's probably going to have the same similar damage. It's going to be kind of rinse and repeat. With the daily claim,
be all over the board.
You have no idea what it's going to be. You have no idea the skill set you're going to need to handle that claim. And so from a firm standpoint and kind of a management standpoint, it's you want someone who's had a proven track record of going, and you can send them that claim and they're going to send it to QA and you don't have to talk to them, essentially. So that's kind of why it's hard to get that start doing daily stuff, and most people get their start doing cat work. Right. And also just the training aspect is we can send out a trainer, you know, and we'll have someone go do a co-inspection with you and they'll help you write it up, and you're going to go back to the conference room at the hotel at the end of the night, and there's going to be trainers there working with you, helping you write up your claims and things like that. And so we're able to provide that on a lot bigger scale during the large cat events as compared to daily stuff.
Okay.
Does that answer?
Yeah, that answered my cool question. Thank you.
Well, but what about like virtual stuff? Do you have any photo and scope stuff?
So yeah, and that's a big thing in the industry right now. We're seeing a lot of things move that direction. You know, I think carriers want to get people off roofs if they don't need to be on roofs. And so you'll see a lot of these newer deployments where it's, I just want you to write up a full estimate based off of policyholder photos or contractor photos, or just work directly with the contractor. Mm-hmm. And so that is definitely a big thing that's like the industry, I think, is moving towards that. A lot of these, they are looking for very skilled, experienced people who have experience handling those field claims. So to get your foot in the door there is sometimes harder as a newer adjuster, but the opportunities are more and more. So I think we'll start to see that. And I think as that develops, we'll start to see kind of even more like kind of training tracks towards that. Because yeah, I mean, I think we all in the industry kind of see that as an issue, is we all want really experienced people, but how can we also help develop people? Because you can't just grow an experience. Yeah, I can't just all of a sudden created a 2-year experience adjuster, I got to give them 2 years of work, you know, and get them there. So I think we'll start to see that more and more. Yeah.
Does April do auto?
Yeah, we do auto. We do a lot more property, I would say, than we do auto, but it's a growing field and it's been blowing up the last 2 years, honestly. I mean, it's been crazy. Yeah, we've been staffing a ton, and a lot of that's virtual and office stuff. We haven't done as much of the drive-in stuff. But I think it's, technology is moving that also just to be virtual, which is great. So a lot of good opportunities. Yeah.
All right. I appreciate it, Josh. Cool. You're welcome to stick around if we've got more questions. Okay. You know,
I'm going to pop back over, but yeah.
Okay. Yeah. We're probably not going to be doing this for too much longer, but
okay, cool.
Yeah. Well, thanks. Thanks, Josh. So yeah, horse's mouth
helpful.
Right there.
Sure. Actually, that was very helpful. Get some information that's what I came here for, was information.
Right.
So that'll help.
Hi, Sherry. How's it going?
Good.
Good to see you. Matt. Good.
Hi, Shane.
Shane, nice to meet
here,
you.
I'll hold this.
Okay. So as a new inspector, just received my license, and I'm looking at trying to break into the business. So I'm going around and seeing everybody.
Right.
I've decided that I need to be the one that decides which company I want to work for. Sure. So I'm more or less interviewing them rather than having them interview me. Because as a new inspector or new adjuster, I'm going to need to know who's going to provide me with the support that I'm going to need when I'm writing my first. I've got a lot of experience, but I haven't done a lot of adjusting. So, you know, are they going to train me on the desk and then put me in the field? What do they have for claims experience? What do they have for Xactimate training? You know, that kind of stuff. So I kind of flipped it since yesterday. Yesterday I was like, who's going to hire me? Who's going to hire me? And then I'm like, hey, you know what? Who do I want to work for
sure.
instead?
Yeah.
So I think that's been a big change for me.
Sure, sure. So what kind of work have you been doing? You said you had a lot of experience, but not a lot of experience.
So I've been 30 years here in Las Vegas as a painting and drywall contractor.
Right. Yeah,
and then before that, I did FEMA CAT deployment.
Okay.
So, and before that, I was a residential home inspector. So I've got construction background, property background. I've flipped a lot of houses and that kind of stuff. So like I sat in the construction module and I was like, okay, so I got this. This is not going to be an issue for me. But I love Xactimate. I was like, oh my God, this stuff is so cool. But it's going to take time. I mean, it's a complicated program. So I need to have somebody who's going to work with me in experiencing how to write a good Xactimate estimate and, you know, counsel me. So that's why I'm finding some of the insurance people, they're not as interested in that. And other ones are very interested in having somebody new with a background, but just needs some hand holding.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, I'm going to guess that some of the companies that are more enthusiastic about it are maybe some of the bigger ones that have training centers and things like, because they're going to want to put you through a lot of that.
Seems like it. Yeah. I'm hearing a lot of things to be aware of from other adjusters here and at the show. So taking that into consideration when I'm talking to the different firms that might want to hire me.
Sure. I've noticed the same thing. There is a lot of the larger ones seem to be the ones with more support teams, more support groups for you, and will be there for you when you're a little better support system, maybe if you're out on a cat.
Yeah.
But that's, since I have no experience, I'm going off what I've heard from other adjusters and also from some of the firms as well.
So,
done, brother.
Good.
Guy Grand.
Shane Kruger, nice to meet you.
Shane, pleasure. You're an adjuster?
No, I'm brand new.
Gotta love it.
Yep.
Yeah. I actually looked into your school a little bit. I never know. Might still end up there.
So,
we're not going anywhere.
Yeah. So, the running joke we have is that you take my training and it gets you on a couple of storms, make enough money to take his training.
There you go. Well,
it's kind of how it works.
Yeah.
We have one of his former students in our class now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Okay. Exactly.
So how's the conference been for you?
You know, I didn't come here to do work. Right?
I didn't either. This isn't work.
So my partner says to me, I'm leaving no more partners and no more students because we're booked all the way through August at this point. Yeah. Right. And so I got here and now we've got a bunch of new students and a bunch of new partners.
Of course.
It's great. Yeah. It's great. No, it's been really, really wonderful. It's been 4 or 5 years since I've been here, but the IA firms have just really stepped up. And I think for you guys, they're really wanting to like open up and see what's happening and give you guys opportunities, which is huge.
It seems that since it's my first time, I don't know, but it seems like they're pretty helpful in that respect. Yes. Trying to bring new people in.
You're going to find in this business that we're all helpful, right? So when you start working for an IA firm, they want you to be successful.
Sure.
So they're going to give you that support once you can break that
the barrier.
And that's the hardest part for sure. And whether you're with him training or with me training or somebody else training, training's the key.
Yeah, that seems to be the repeated message everywhere I go.
Does it?
Training, training, more training.
Yeah.
And it's not that it has to be. It's just that that's what's going to make them feel better about you and you be more comfortable in the field.
And when you actually get in the field, it's with, right? You're you're always learning.
Right.
But at least if you know the process, when you get in the field, it makes it so much easier.
Yeah. Having a framework, having a system, even if later on you change the system to suit you, you think you, it's more comfortable for you to run claims. If you got something to start with, got a little boat so you can sit in with a oar. You know,
even
later on,
a little bit, you got one toe in the
bottom. Then later on, you can like upgrade to a speed boat or change the color of your oar or whatever you want to do.
Exactly correct. Exactly correct. You know, I tell all my students that no matter what training you get him, me or whatever, you got to do 100 claims because then you will have seen all of the scenarios.
Yeah.
Maybe not all of them, but most of them, you'll see the different parts and pieces. And that's really where the education comes in is once you get in the field.
That makes sense. Yeah, I can understand how that would definitely be it. But I can also understand with the training, like you guys said, you build a foundation, you have something to go off of, understanding how to schedule your time, what to do when you get there, how to get proper photos, scope it properly, the things to look for, mistakes not to make. I can see where all that training comes into that. So when you get in the field, you're not just completely lost.
Yeah. Which is exactly what happens.
Matt and I, most of our stories and our training is based on what not to do.
Honestly, I was telling him that earlier. I've picked up on what not to do is every bit as important as what to do.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
And we pretty much know what not to do, don't we?
I don't know. There's always something that pops up. And it's just in general where it's like, I should not have done that. And that was 3 hours ago. So I don't know. Right on. So let's talk a little bit about this conference. I know you haven't been here, but I know also that you value networking. Maybe kind of talk a little bit about the benefits of this conference for new and even experienced adjusters.
Well, for the new adjuster, just like I was saying a couple minutes ago, just literally being able to go and seeing what these IA firms offer, what they offer in the form of training and that kind of stuff. When I became an adjuster at the end of December, long time ago, but that January I came here. I had no idea what an adjuster was. I knew National Association of Catastrophe Adjusters. And it really opened my eyes to what's going on because these folks are going to tell you what's real and what's happening. And you're going to get to see, you know, different companies do things differently. They have different onboarding, all the rest of that stuff, but you're going to get to see it. For me, now, in there, right, 22 of our partners are here. So for me, it's coming and actually putting a lot of these recruiters from these companies I've never met. I've worked with for 8 years. But I've never connected to them. So that's the networking. It really is putting a face, hi, I'm so-and-so, this is what's happening. And you notice I didn't wear a Voss shirt, so nobody will recognize me.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great disguise guy.
I don't know how that worked out for you. I don't know you at all, but I've seen you enough on his program and enough stuff. I recognized you right away.
What time we got, Max? Max. Okay. All right, so for those who don't know, maybe give a little description of Veteran Adjusting School.
Okay. Here's the 10 floor, 20 floor elevator pitch.
Yeah, 12 floor elevator pitch.
12 floor, so I don't take 3 hours. Veteran Adjusting School is the only school in the country that is approved by the VA for GI Bill benefits. And we are also licensed by the Board of Education for training adjusters. And I say that because if I tell you there's a 2-hour ethics course, it has to be a 2-hour ethics course because we're audited by the federal and the state government every year. So what we say in our curriculum, what we say that we're going to do, we have to do, you know, all the way down to the, to our enrollment agreement. There's things in the enrollment agreement that this is how refunds happen. And there are no discounts because if I give you a discount, then I have to give everybody a discount. So there's a lot of regulation that comes down upon us, which I think is really good because that lets the student come into the school know that this is real, this is solid. And the other part of that is we're 96% job placement, less than 20 days to the first claim from the school.
It's less than 20 days now?
Less than 20
days. I think it was 23 last time I talked to you.
It went down.
We had a couple hurricanes that happened in the last year.
That helps the averages, I'm right. Sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
Totally.
When I can put -1 because everybody went to the storm, I'm like, okay, that's good. You're up in my average.
So any news or anything, new things you guys are doing at the school you want to share with us or no?
I'm going to edit this. I'm actually going to edit it anyway and post.
Okay, good. Well, so the newest thing that's happening this class is we're now doing an entire day of civility.
Okay.
So we're going to take them through the onboarding into civility and the basics of civility. And then civility is actually going to come in and do an afternoon training to actually write an estimate. And that will be an estimate that they wrote 2 weeks before an Xactimate. So they're going to literally be able to see the same photographs, same scope notes, same everything else, and then write a claim in both Xactimate and in civility.
Nice.
So they can see how it is. Yeah, it's a new thing that we just started. So
that's a big deal.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm really excited about it. Awesome. Other than that, curriculum's a curriculum, right? We're 8 days of Xactimate training. So we don't train to the test. We train to the book and all the parts and pieces of the book and that kind of stuff.
And then it's 5 more weeks or, you know, roughly of simulation, more or less, right?
Yeah, pretty much, right? So we have a whole storm week where you literally, everybody will come in after lunch on a Tuesday and we'll say, wow, we just had a storm. Here's your 6 claims. And they literally have to call the insureds, go through the whole process of the inspection, write the estimate, turn the estimate in. And these are all people that they've never met. And these are all houses they've never seen because my wife and I are fortunate enough that we have lots of friends. Mm-hmm. And so they allow me to let 45 people a year crawl around on their roof. It's amazing. Yeah. I mean, I bought a couple roofs, but it's well worth it for our standpoint, right? Just to make sure we're not messing up our friends' houses. Mm-hmm. But to have them play that insured, have them play that real. And I tell everybody, you know, it's better to do those first 6 claims in our controlled chaos then when you get out there in the field and nobody's there to support you, nobody's there to call you and
immediate answer.
Exactly. So yeah, really, really blessed. And this class will be 290 people that we've changed their lives. So it's really
yeah. And you know, I think one of the key things about Veteran Adjusting School is that they limited it to 45, to five classes of 9,
yeah.
Period, for the last, 10, 15 years?
Since the beginning.
Yeah, and so that allows them to maintain a high level of quality. It's not getting franchised out and diluted.
Right.
It's, you know, yeah. Guy is, he's the guy, right? And then you've got guy's phone number, and you got...
So it's a 9-person maximum for your
nine
class?
Person maximum.
Nice.
Per
three
class.
Instructors.
Three, so basically
three instructors and 9 people.
Yeah.
That's a lot of one-on-one attention.
Yeah, exactly. So... If somebody glitches in the class, all they have to do is raise their hand, and one of us is right there to. Our whole school is all progression, so everything that happens today needs to happen. You need to know it because tomorrow's a whole day, and it builds upon the first day and the second day, and et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, for us, whether the person doesn't know a computer really well, but we know that going in. So one of us is sitting by. So right. If we say push this button and somebody goes, we're like this button. Oh, okay. That button. Now push that button again. Okay. Do that 20 more times so your brain remembers that's the button. That kind of stuff. So yeah, it's really like I said, it's since we started the school, our goal has never been about growing or expanding. We've had several of these people here that have tried to buy us over the years.
Oh wow.
That have the money to expand and do all that kind of stuff, but it wouldn't be the same, right? You wouldn't have the one-on-one connection in that school, but also you're with us forever. I mean, I still, 5 years later, get people that call up and say, what's this? And they'll shoot a text, and then we'll give them a selector code and category and send them on their way.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Great. See ya.
So you're still a great resource years down the road.
Always.
Nice.
Always. We're like a little family. Dysfunctional as it may be, but we're a little family.
Every family's cool. Dysfunctional.
Absolutely.
In some way.
The primary reason you're here is to see your students, right?
Well, and that is also the primary reason I'm here, too, is I think and there's probably 12 or 13 of our students that have come in, which is really awesome, too, because they go around to these people and they're like, here's my veteran adjusting school resume. And everybody's like, oh my God, you're with veteran adjusting school. And then, you know, all of our students get an email address, right? So that says .VAS on it. Their Xactimate account is .VAS on it. So these IA firms know when they bring one of them on board, they look at their exact analysis address or they look at their email and they're like, great, I know exactly where they came from. So.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, seems like it. Seems very in depth, and it's amazing that you're always there to help.
Yeah.
Well, I can do that by being small.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
And then our classes are 6 weeks on, 3 weeks off. Right. So once I get somebody out of school, I can help them get placed. I can help them with their first claim, and then maybe it's text messages through the next class with the last class. And then once they run 5 or 10 claims, then they can, because once you do that, you're going to connect to the managers and the file reviewers at the company. And that's really what it's all about, is you building that relationship with the people that you're working with. What can I do better? Getting a kickback is the most awesome thing you can do when you're a new adjuster. You relish those because then it gives you the ability to talk. Absolutely. And write that down. Oh, don't forget that.
Don't do that again.
Yeah,
exactly.
What not to do.
Exactly. So yeah, it's pretty cool that my students are coming here and they're meeting and greeting, and all of them, everybody that's here is already working pretty much full time, but they're just expanding their horizons and meeting different companies and stuff like that. So
I've talked to a lot of adjusters that are trying to, maybe they've just been doing property, now they want to do property and focus more on flood, or a lot of guys that are experienced coming here to connect in a different way,
correct,
try to move into something different. So I've noticed that quite a bit of that.
Correct. Yeah. So listen, so you've got, when's your next group?
My lead instructor kicked me out this week.
Oh, I was like, surely I thought you
we're
maybe
in session.
I was gonna say, surely you've got a session. No,
we're
now.
We're in session right now.
So, all right.
So we did, last week was the first week.
Okay.
And this week is the Xactimate proficiency, and Thursday is the Xactimate test, and I'll be back on Thursday.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
So my question for you is,
you have a question.
Can me and Max come down again this spring?
Max can.
No.
Oh my gosh.
Bye.
I didn't say that. Absolutely. And I have some different houses now.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, so we could do a lot of cool stuff.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. I've got some ideas for more, like, targeted, like, so just doing, like, a whole claim. We could do little pieces of claims and things. But that, I think a lot of, I mean, you tell me, in Adjuster TV Plus, you know, I have a lot of content with Guy.
You do?
And, you know, I think it's some of the best stuff we've done.
Yeah.
What do you think about it?
I would agree. There's a lot. Between the two of you, there's a lot of experience and just a lot of interaction between the two of you that brings that out. So, yeah, it's a good opportunity to, for any of us that don't know what we're looking at or doing, to get that, see, get some experience just through what you're showing and teaching. So, yeah, it's definitely some of the best stuff you got.
One of the things that hopefully comes through with what you and I do is he's his own adjuster and I'm my own adjuster. It doesn't mean that we necessarily do the same thing exactly the same way, but the process is still basically the same.
For sure.
Right?
100%.
One thing I remember from your videos from you two together, you would scope a house starting, I think you were going right to left.
He goes right to left.
And you go left to right, and yours had to do with something in your military experience.
When you're in the military, you step left. So right when they're
so
ready, they
on
step
the roof talking about it, and I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Either way, go one way, but do it the same way every time.
Every single.
That was exactly. Whatever your system is, that's your system. Yeah. And do it from time you start to the time you end. That way you know you've covered everything.
You know, when you show up at a house with an insured, you have to take control. Because if you don't take control, you're going to lose your system. Right? And if what I do is I always do roof, front, left, rear, right, then I need to tell the insured, this is what I do. Roof, front, left, rear, right. We can get together, you can follow me, whatever, but this is how it happens. Because inevitably, especially after a big storm, inevitably the insured wants to show you the damage that they know is the worst.
Right.
So come look at this.
Exactly.
And as soon as you step that way, you're done.
Because you stepped out of your norm.
You stepped out of your norm, and trying to come back to focus on that, or now start taking your photographs in order and that kind of stuff. It's just.
Yeah.
You lose your place, and that's where you start to miss damage. And then you're, if you don't like import and label your photos while you're sitting at the house, later on, you're going through your photos. You're like, oh my gosh, I didn't get the back side of the house. And there's a big old awning, and you can see there's, you know, I didn't get the measurements on that.
Yeah.
It happens, and they all blur together, right? So it's not like I'm totally gonna remember this, you know.
They do all blur together. That is for sure. About the fourth one in the day, it's all a blur.
Yes.
Yeah. And you know, if you ran three claims in a day, you're sometimes taking 300 or 400 photographs. So you got to remember, when I took that photograph, what did that photograph say?
Right.
What did that mean? What did that mean? What did that mean? And what Matt talks about as far as doing your photos while you're still there, great idea. Did I ever do that? Never.
Well, I closed them on site, so I did the whole thing.
That was a whole big difference.
Yeah.
You know, but I can tell you my photos were always in order. So if I wasn't sure if this was a left or a right, I know if the front was the first, this was a left.
This is the left.
This is the left.
And that's the importance of the process.
Correct.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Exactly. Process is key. And that's where the speed starts to come in, because you start to build efficiencies into your process. It's not that you're moving faster, but it's that you're taking less time to do a thing, right?
That's exactly correct.
James Mathis is getting ready to drop in. James Mathis, welcome to the live stream.
We're shaking bacon. This is the entertainment.
This is the entertainment. Yeah, we put him on as the entertainment.
I saw the conference is going for you.
The conference is incredible. This is, of course, in my 4 years of coming, this is the most people I've ever seen. I've literally seen people left the conference early to because they had claims. They got work. They were willing to go. Somebody wanted to go. This one guy left here a day, left yesterday, came in yesterday, talked to somebody, packed his stuff up, flew back to Houston to get his truck and go wreck claims. He was only here for a day. That was pretty cool. That's great. So, again, seeing all of our friends that, that we see every year out here, all the other firms that, we create these friendships with through the years, been fantastic to see them again. Also, some of the same adjusters from last year and the year before. Year before, a lot from last year. Of course, the year before we were in Orlando, but some of those people are here this year. So it's been a really good, really good conference so far. What about you guys, Sugar Shane?
Oh, it's awesome. I was thinking about something that as we were talking about different pieces of information, and you were talking about how things blur together after you've been at four different places writing up claims for the day. One thing I've noticed for me, being new to all of this, as I talk to different vendors, different IA firms, definitely when you talk to them, write down the information you got from that one right as you do it. If you're supposed to email them, write it down. If they're going to email you, write it down. Who you talk to. Because it wasn't even a day. It was like three or four down. And I was like, wait, who told me to email them? And who was I supposed to talk to? So I learned quickly to write it all down. But
not only does he have a beautiful head like I do, he also has ADD like I do. Well,
bang, bang, bang. Yeah.
That's it. Exactly. We lose the hair, we lose the mind.
That's right. Yeah, that was what held everything together. Now there's nothing. Exactly.
So I have to tell you that one of the highlights for me this week is running it. Guy Grant. That was it. He knew what I was going to say, man. Seen this guy before, on some of the match videos, and I'm sitting there going, man, that's a cool cat. I'm going to hang with this dude, and so we've had some pretty good conversations. Really good to meet you, Guy. So here you go, man.
Yeah, so again, back to like Adjuster TV coming to
let's get back to Adjuster.
Sedona. No, listen. To come into Sedona in the spring, you say when and we'll try to get it scheduled and we'll see if we can get James Mathis to come with us.
That'd be awesome.
And then
that'd be awesome. So I would do that. We're the end of April. So maybe the last week of April for one or two weeks in the first weeks of May is in between our next class. And that's also when the weather's probably the best, because once that May class hits, June, July is just prohibitive to climb on roofs, if nothing else. Right. But it's also too hot to go hiking and hanging out.
I want to come during class time.
You, might be able to come during class time. So our classroom has 9 student desks, 2 instructor desks, and a podium.
It'd be really nice to come. I mean, it's been a long time since I was a class clown, and I can do that. And it's also been a long time since I stood behind a podium.
You've been doing this since you've been here, James, class clown.
It's been a long time since I stood behind a podium and didn't have to enter a plea. So,
right?
Yeah, right. Exactly.
So we allow people to come in at the end of week 6. Right, because it's kind of like the downtime after most of the other stuff's get done. It gets really hard to have people sit in the class when they're in the middle of writing claims or they're in the middle of doing that kind of stuff. They think it's great, but then I got to pay attention to them. And so, we don't let our partners come in until week 6. Sometimes we'll do a 10-minute Zoom first thing in the morning. But I'll make them come in 15 minutes early so we can do that Zoom before we get started.
As we've discussed, I actually manage a couple of your graduates, and they are always very well prepared. I don't have to worry about those guys. I don't have to follow up on them. We talk about one of them. He just needs to pull the trigger every now and then and make a decision. And finally got through to him 2 weeks ago. And said the one thing I've always said, which was what I learned in one of my first storms, just make a decision. The roads are littered with squirrels who can't make decisions, and he finally got it. So
that's true.
Yep.
Thanks.
Yeah, awesome.
Thanks for taking care of them.
They're good. They're very well trained, and they're good. Their photo documentation and their their loss reports. Fantastic. So
we spend a lot of time on that.
It's important.
You know, the other thing that we spend a lot of time on is the soft skills. Respond to your manager. Follow up with that email. You know, those kind of things. And don't be afraid to call on somebody that's willing to help. And we said this before you sat down, James, is one of the things that's so great here is you're going to support Shane, who's a new guy, or anybody, just because we love the business as much as we love the business. Right? So,
you know, and as a manager too, I have people call me all the time who I've never met. They've never worked for me. They don't work for the same firm I work for. And they've just made these relationships from, you know, Adjuster TV and coming to these conferences. And they call me and ask me for help. And because I love this business so much, I love sharing knowledge, and I help them, you know, just help them out. And you're right. That's what we do. I mean, Matt himself, I mean, I wouldn't be sitting here if it wasn't for Matt, obviously. But I mean, I wouldn't have continued my career as an adjuster had it not been for Matt reaching out to me.
That's why I do the YouTube channel.
And not so many people would know me if it wasn't for Matt.
Dang it.
Nobody would know me.
All right. Well, listen, I'm going to go ahead.
Thank you anyway.
Yeah, of course. We'll go ahead and button this up. But thank you guys so much for watching. As always, have a great storm.
Peace out.
You're watching Adjuster TV.